Everybody, I hope you enjoyed the April Fool's joke. Some people still don't understand it was a joke by the emails I've been getting. So just understand there was no letter. I made the whole thing up. I'm still going to do the videos. So thanks for the support for everybody that did contact me. Today's vlog is a little different. You're either going to love it or you're going to hate it. Put on some comfy clothes, make a cup of coffee, and settle in because this one's going to be a fun one. Coffee is just about done. Let's get it going. The word that is key. First off, how do we know there's a word that is key? Well, we know because Forrest said so. On Jenny Kyle's site, she did a Q&A with him. She's done it many times. And one of his answers were, many searchers have given serious thought to the clues in my poem, but only a few are in tight focus with a word that is key. The treasure may be discovered sooner than I anticipated. So there is a word that's key. In my opinion, it is in the poem. Before he said there's a word that's key, right above it, the sentence above it, he says many searchers are giving serious thought to the clues in my poem. So he's talking about the poem. And then he says, but few are in tight focus with a word that is key. First off, you're going to have to think a little differently on this, all right? You know, one time Forrest put out the link to Smarter Every Day on YouTube. And if you haven't seen it, look up Smarter Every Day on YouTube. You'll see that their featured video is riding a backwards bicycle and how you can't do it. Your brain is just wired a certain way. It took a guy over a year to learn how to ride this bicycle. We got to change how we look at the poem. What I'm about to show you, it takes a lot to believe it, one. But instead of just showing you, I'm actually going to show you how we arrive at it, show you the methodology. And you got to change how you look at the poem. It's not going to be easy for a lot of people. But hang in there and we'll get through it together. Here's a question for you. How many words are in the poem? Do you know? How many words are in the poem? There's 166 words in the poem. 166 words. Forrest said it took him 15 years to write that poem and every word is deliberate. He also said an architect wrote that poem. Keep that in mind as we go through this. Let's look at the first stanza. As I have gone alone in there and with my treasures bold, I can keep my secret where and hint of riches new and old. There's a certain word in the first stanza that he draws our attention to. He says that treasures are bold. And with my treasures, bold. Now, I know what you're thinking. Those are the treasures that he put in the chest. And that's why they're bold, because they're worth so much money, and it's gold, and it's shiny, and we're all looking for it. Change how you think about the poem. With my treasures, bold. Let's just focus on the poem. Just the poem itself. You know how Forrest said, give the poem to a child? I often think that might be because they read it differently than adults do. As I have gone alone in there, and with my treasures bold, I can keep my secret where, and hint of riches new and old. Why are treasures bold? Not what he put in the chest. Forget about the chest. Why is the word treasures bold in this poem, in this 166-word poem? Look at the word treasures. Look at it. Pull out your list. Pull out your book. Pause the video. Bring up the poem on the internet, and look at just the first stanza. As I have gone alone in there, and with my treasures bold, I can keep my secret where, and hint of riches new and old. The word treasures, why is it bold? A definition of bold is to be conspicuous, to draw attention to. The word treasures in the poem is bold because, have you got it? Have you figured it out yet? Because it's the only word in this entire 166-word poem that is nine letters. Treasures, nine letters. All the other words in the poem are not even eight letters. All the other words in the poem are seven letters or less. Treasures is bold because it's the longest word in the poem. It's 9 letters. But let's read the first stanza again. As I have gone alone in there and with my treasures bold, not the gold in the chest, the word treasures in the poem, I can keep my secret where? I can keep my secret where? In the poem. What I'm trying to get you to look at is just the poem. Forget about the Rocky Mountains. Forget about the big map. Let's just concentrate on the poem, which is originally how Forrest wanted this done. All you need is the poem. As I, who? Forrest Fenn. He's the one who wrote the poem. Have gone alone in there. Where? Where he hid the chest? No. As Forrest Fenn has gone alone in this poem. As I have gone alone in there, as he's writing the poem. Remember, it took him 15 years to write the poem. Read it like this. As Forrest Fenn has gone alone in the poem, and with the word treasures bold, I can keep my secret where? In the poem. There's a secret in the poem. I'm going to show you how to reveal the secret using the word that is key. And that word is treasures. And hint of riches, new and old. You know, in this poem, he could have used the word treasures over again several times, right? Riches could be another word for treasures. Gold, title to the gold. He could have said title to the treasures. Trove, and leave my trove for all to seek. All these words, he could have used treasures again if he wanted to, but he didn't. One, to make the poem rhyme, but two, because he only wanted it in here once, in the very first stanza, so that he could draw attention to it. Make sense so far? You with me? As Forrest has gone alone in the poem, writing the poem, and with the word treasures, which is bold. Why is it bold? Because it's the only word in the entire 166-word poem that has 9 letters. It stands out. It's the longest word in the poem. I, Forrest Fenn, can keep my secret where? In the poem. There's a secret in the poem. And hint of riches new and old. The hint of riches new and old is the word treasures. The hint he's trying to get through to us is that there's something going on with that word treasures. It's the word that's key. It's the word we need to focus in on. Okay? So that's why I believe treasures, T-R-E-A-S-U-R-E-S, 9 letters, is the word that is key. Make sense? Now, what do we do with it? If you agree with me that treasures is the word that is key, what do we do with it? Well, let's see what we do with it. We're going to do with it what the poem says to do with it. Let's go to the second verse. Begin it where warm waters halt and take it in the canyon down, comma. Not far, but too far to walk, period. Put in below the home of brown, period. Begin it where warm waters halt. What is it? It's our journey, our search. No. Change how you're reading this poem. It, only using the poem and nothing else. It is the word that is key from the first stanza. Begin treasures, the word treasures, where warm waters halt. Begin it where warm waters halt. Begin treasures where warm waters halt. Why? Because treasures is the word that is key. Well, how do we do that? How do you begin the word treasures where warm waters halt? This is going to be a little tricky for some of you guys. Just keep an open mind and remember the backward bicycle. We need to change our thought process and how we look. We begin treasures where warm waters halt because where warm waters halt is on the T in halt. Let me say that again. Begin it, treasures, where warm waters halt. It halts on the T. Treasure starts with the letter T. We're going to begin the word treasures on the T in halt. And take it in the canyon down. What is it? It is the word treasures. Begin treasures where warm waters halt and take treasures in the canyon down. Not far, but too far to walk. Take treasures in the canyon down. Not a canyon in the Rocky Mountains in this poem. Take the word treasures in the canyon down. Spell the word treasures down the poem. We're starting on the letter T in halt. Okay? Not far, but too far to walk. We're not going anywhere yet. This is in the poem. For now, this is in the poem. It's not far, but it's too far to walk. Don't get out of your chair. Do this while you're at home. Okay? Put in below the home of Brown. Another, if you look up put in, another definition is to study or devote time to. Study or devote time below the home of Brown. The home of Brown is this line. We go to the next line to put in what? To put in the word treasures below the home of Brown. Let's recap real quick. As I, Forrest Fenn, have gone alone in there. Where's in there? It's in the poem. Everything we're talking about is the poem. All you need is the poem, remember? And with my treasures bold. Why is the word treasures bold? Because it's the only word in this 166-word poem that has 9 letters. It's the longest word of the poem. I, Forrest Fenn, can keep my secret where? In the poem. There's a secret in the poem. And hint of riches, new and old. He's hinting that riches, new and old. The word treasure, another word for riches. Treasures, new and old. We've got it once. That's the old. We need to find it again. That's the new. Hint of riches, new and old. Okay? Word that's key is treasures. We use it on the poem. I'm about to show you right now how we do that. Begin it where warm waters halt. It is the word treasures from the first stanza. Begin treasures where warm waters halt. How do we do that? We spell the word treasures starting with the T in halt. Where warm waters halt is on this line at the T. But wait a minute, what's treasures got to do with warm waters? It doesn't. Warm waters is just a placeholder for a clue. It could have said, begin your journey on this line. As long as the line ends in a T with the word halt, meaning stop at the end of this line, he could have put anything he wanted to in there. Begin it where gold halts. And we'd all run to the Rocky Mountains trying to find out where that is. Begin it where the rain halts. But also, look at it. Now I'm getting confused. Try and explain it. Halt had to end on the T. It couldn't be halts, plural. That's why warm waters is plural, so that they halt. And that line ends on a T. It has to end on a T, because that's where we start the word treasures. Now, before you turn this off and say, preposterous, blasphemy, it's crazy, I don't want to listen to it anymore. The poem took 15 years to write. Every word is deliberate, and an architect wrote this poem. Give the poem to a child. If you tell the child, hey, where do warm waters halt? He may look at it and say, on the T. That's where it halts, on the T. The line stops right there on the T. It halted. Right? Begin treasures where warm waters halt. And take treasures in the canyon down. What canyon? There is no canyon. In the poem. Take treasures in the poem down. We're going to use the word that is key, treasures, and we're going to spell it down, crossword style, in the poem. Do you get it? Not far, but too far to walk. We're not going anywhere. This is just in the poem. Later, we'll worry about the actual 9 clues and going to the Rocky Mountains and using the map and everything else. Right now, I'm trying to show you how we use the word that is key on the poem. Put in below the home of Brown. Put in below this line. Home of Brown. He could have put anything. Put in below this sentence. That's basically what he's telling us. Put in below the home of Brown. So we don't use this line. Now, let me point something out to you, and I hope I can make it line up correctly over here so you can see it. What I did is I put the poem in an Excel spreadsheet. Each letter, including punctuation, is in its own cell. Square, 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 square. H-A-L-T. So it's all lined up properly. Left justify it. The poem lines up here. Nice and neat. If you look at the T in halt in the second stanza, the two lines below it are to the left of the T, and the period in Brown is directly below the T. Okay? Just keep that in mind. From there, it's no place for the meek. Well, if we're using the word that is key, which is treasures, and we're spelling it in the poem, we use the T on halt. What's the next letter in treasures? R. We need an R in this line. We skipped put in below the home of Brown because it said put in below the home of Brown. So from there, it's no place for the meek. We have two different R's we can choose, right? Which R do we use to spell treasures? From there, from the R. From the R, we use the R in there. How do we do that? We slide the line over until the R is directly below the T in halt. Okay? The end is ever drawing nigh. The end is ever drawing nigh. Now we need an E. T-R-E. Which E do we use? We have one, two different E's in this line. Which one do we use? The E in end. He's telling us, use the E. We slide it over, so the E is directly under the T, the E is directly under the R in the line above it, okay? There'll be no paddle up your creek. Don't use this line. There'll be no paddle up your creek. Slide it to the left so that the punctuation lines up under the T in halt, just like it did in the second stanza, okay? Okay, I thought this would be easier if I just show you my Excel spreadsheet. This is the poem left justified. Everything is lined up on the left-hand side. Each cell or each box has got a letter, including the punctuation. So in the first stanza, we realize that treasure is the word that's key, so we're going to cover up the first stanza to make it easier to see. It's kind of busy. If you look at halt, the punctuation lines up right below it in the second stanza. And then we go down, starting on the T, putting in below the home of Brown, we slide these lines left-right in order to spell the word treasures down the middle. And this is what it looks like when you've done that and you spell treasures down the middle of the poem. Using the T in halt, using the R in there, from the R, using the E in end, the E. There'll be no paddle up our creek, so we slide it to the left. So the punctuation is directly under the T. In halt, just like it was in this stanza. Just heavy loads and water high. We use the A in loads, the S in wise, the U in your, the R in marvel, the E in chest. You see a pattern here? The third letter in all of these words. Why is it that I must go is not long enough to reach? So we leave this exactly the way it is. And leave my trove for all to seek. Isn't it interesting that the T in halt and the S in seek line up perfectly, beginning and end to start treasures? We don't have to slide those lines left, right. So the beginning and end, the T and S, are perfect right where they are. All we're doing is literally what the poem is telling us to do with the word treasures. I'll give you a minute just to check this out, soak it in. I know it's a lot to take in. From the R, from the E, we slide. Because there's no paddle up our creek, we slide this one to the left. The third letter in all these words. Does it look like a pattern? Does it look like random coincidence to you, or does it look like a pattern? It looks like a pattern to me. Taking the word that's key, we've done exactly what it says in the poem. If you read this literally, if you change how you think, if you learn how to ride that backward bicycle, and you change how you look at the poem. So what does that do for us? We spelled treasures down the center of the poem. How does that help? There is a message in the poem when you do this, what we've just done, when you spell treasures down the center of the poem, or not the center, but down the poem. And you know, the other thing I thought is if you've been wise and found the blaze, look quickly down your quest to seek. Did we just strike a blaze down the poem using the word treasures? Do we look quickly down because we're reading down the poem? Isn't that interesting? But tarry scant with marvel gaze that Forrest Fenn could have created this for 15 years, that if we slide these lines left to right using the word that is key, it spells a message. Just take the chest and go in peace. So what is the message? This one is getting kind of long. The vlog is getting kind of long. I know it takes a lot to try and explain this in a coherent way to you guys. So I'm going to wrap it up for now, and we'll do it again next time. If you like the video, hit the thumbs up. No, I'm just kidding, guys. I wouldn't leave you hanging like that. If you line up the poem so it spells the word treasures, and you look right here in the center, there is a message. We're reading down, crossword style, and here it is. Try the wheel. Try the wheel. I know what you're saying. Well, you could make words out of any of this. And that's true. And if the message was here, here, and here, well, then it would be random, right? If I'm going this way and then that way, I'm sure we can make all kinds of words. But try the wheel is right here. One cell up every time, all together, right in a row. Try the wheel. And look what's interesting right here. You think it's coincidence? The forms a cross right here in the very center of the message. T-H-E vertically, T-H-E horizontally. Try the wheel. So, I know we're 21 minutes into the vlog, but I gotta say a couple of things. First, I did not come up with this solution for using treasures on the poem. Somebody else did. Some of the long-term searchers know about this. The mistake that I think we made back then is we read the message wrong. If you go back and you look where the message is, it says try the wheel, but below wheel it says WY. And back then, I at least thought that the WY stood for Wyoming. So I was looking for a wheel in Wyoming. And if you Google Wyoming and wheel, you're going to come to one very specific place. One very large place that definitely fits, or I think Forrest Fenn might have wanted to go to die and leave his bones, which was his original plan. The medicine wheel in Wyoming is a very old place. They think it was built by the Indians. It's a very spiritual place. But what do we do with it? It's a historical landmark. I don't think Forrest was going to go there and leave his bones at the medicine wheel that people visit every year. And we couldn't make it work. And I just kind of left it in the notes and let go of it for a long time and just didn't know what to do with it. But as I started doing these vlogs, I realized that try the wheel is the message. And once I realized that, a couple things clicked. Let's go back to vlog number one, the map and too far to walk. What was my theory in vlog number one? That the place where the treasure is hidden is listed on that map. The actual name of the place is on the map, right? Vlog number one. Vlog number two, where warm waters halt. There's no way for us to tell where the warm waters halt. He's got to tell us somehow in the thrill of the chase. One of the hints has got to be to where warm waters halt. Vlog number four, hints in the thrill of the chase. We came up that borders was a hint. Vlog number five was the latitude longitude. It brought us to a specific area on the map, and it was at the border between Colorado and New Mexico. And this is vlog number six. And using this message of try the wheel can take us to one very specific spot within that search area. So what do you guys think? Far-fetched? Crazy? Unbelievable? Do you love it? Do you hate it? All I can say is, to me, it looks intentional. Watch the video again. It's a lot to take in. But when you match it up with some of the things he said about 15 years, every word's deliberate, an architect wrote the poem, give the poem to a child. As far as, to me, where warm waters halt, the line halts on the T. I think it's very interesting. And when it lines up with our borders clue and our latitude-longitude clue, tell me what you think. If you like the video, subscribe. Share it, comment, email me, send me mail. I will see you next time, and I will leave you with this.